In 1995, I was working with a gifted, nonverbal boy with autism who spoke his first word on the back of his horse. Fast forward 30 years, and we are now developing a scientific body of evidence that supports what we've known all along. Through partnering with researchers, we are now helping to quantify the impacts of this powerful connection. In 2010, Dr. Gabriels conducted the largest randomized controlled trial to date on the impacts of therapeutic riding with youth diagnosed with autism. She found highly significant results, which showed decreases in hyperactivity and irritability, as well as significant increases in social communication and cognition.
The other positive findings post the 10 weeks compared to the barn group were that they used significant more words and new words during a language sample, which that was unusual to me, as I thought, we're not teaching people how to talk when they're on the horse, but these kids in the conversation for 5 minutes with a speech therapist who had no idea which group they were in, they had some major language changes.
I am Becky Hyland. EJ is 12 now. He was 11 when he started here. He is adopted. We adopted him when he was 4. We've had him since he was 3. He has autism and cerebral palsy, and he also has apraxia, speech delays. He is definitely a light at the end of any dark day. If you have a bad day and you see EJ, it will lighten your day. Huh? What's the best thing about you?
I help a lot.
You do help a lot. I think in the long run, his smile is probably his most prized possession. Huh?
Yeah.
When we were originally asked to be a part of this group, one of my things that held me back a little bit was that I know how scared he is of animals. He walks past them and he just cries. So we were nervous to have him be a part of this because of that anxiety for him.
I'm passionate about it because I love finding things that can help kids with autism. Individuals who have autism have special interests and things they do very well. They have a hard time with emotion regulation. They have a hard time explaining themselves. Of course, they're going to get upset. So that's kind of in kids with autism. And they have just extraordinary skill. You just have to get to know them and understand how to engage them and pull that out. We were hypothesizing that perhaps because of the history of thinking about animals and humans, that it may be regulating. And maybe when you're regulated, you're gonna show more of who you are as a person and be able to do more things in life.
When we were told at the onset that she was autism level 3, that means maximum needs for her whole life. But through the process of getting her these therapies and stuff, we were able to give her the best chance of a normal future.
Dr. Gabriels is now looking into the physiological mechanisms that might explain the significant results from her previous study.
We designed a multi-site 5-year study with several different treatments. Primarily, groups of youth with autism rode horses for 10 weeks, while the control group, called the Barn Activity Group, came to the ranch, learned all about horses, but never touched a horse. Instead, all their learning came through interacting with a large stuffed horse.
So what is explaining therapeutic riding? We went ahead and applied again for another study with National Institutes of Health. We wanted to look at the mechanisms. We are looking at the physiology, the mechanisms of how therapeutic riding is helpful. And we're doing that through cortisol, which is a stress hormone in the saliva. We're looking at that both before and after the groups, both groups, the riding group and the barn group. And we're also looking at kids are wearing heart rate monitors, and we're also looking at skin temperature changes.
Since 2020, over 150 youth with autism have had this unique experience of being part of the study.
Mia was randomly chosen to be a rider for this study, and Mia had never been on a horse before. And she had said that the horses were big animals and she was afraid of big animals. It turned out to be an absolutely fabulous thing for her. Mia came to our family through foster care. She was 9 and she was very quiet. She was mainly nonverbal. She used some signing and had a communication device that she used. So Hearts and Horses is a special place. When we first came here, Mia was a little resistant. She said she may ride a horse. She did get on the horse and she's been hooked ever since. She's talked about my horse, so this is her place. The sidewalker and the lead are her boys. Over the course of the study, she improved her posture, her strength, her smile, her holding of her head. Her back didn't hurt anymore. During this study, she learned how to ride a bike as well. She found the courage and the strength in her to get on the bike. During this study, Mia would say she felt calm and she felt happy. Those words and those feelings, she doesn't say it that often. But for her to make that connection that her body felt calm and her body and her heart felt happy being here, amazing to be in touch with those feelings. The night before coming back for the for her lessons, she got up early. She got up at about 4 a.m. This is the growth that, you know, she's had. I said, wow, you're up early. And she was able on her own to say, I am happy and I am excited for horse.
I really wanted her in the barn group because my ultimate goal is to make sure that my neurodivergent child can survive in what is essentially a neurotypical world. As she got up this morning, got herself ready, had her shower, brushed out her hair, got on her clothes herself, because she said that she had to go to her job, which was learning about horses. So already she's getting that to be able to come to her horse group, there are certain steps that that have to be made.
If we can show that horseback riding is regulating for this population, maybe there can be a reduced need for excessive medications, hospitalizations, and there can be wider access to care through insurance companies recognizing therapeutic riding as a valid intervention. We hope the results of this study will act as a catalyst to inform the practice of equine-assisted services, not only in our local community, but worldwide.
The fact that he gained independence just from being here helped me immensely. He advocates for himself way more now than he did before, and he does it in a calmer way. So instead of hitting himself in the head, he goes and gets somebody's attention. And that's all stemmed from when he was here. He still talks about it a year later, so it is great.
Seeing that smile while she's on the horse, that genuine peace, that makes me feel hopeful. Seeing your child who's had so much pain, so much trauma, so much challenge in her life with day-to-day things, to see her smile for a whole hour is pretty powerful.